Tantor Audio presents What Should We Be Worried About? Real Scenarios That Keep Scientists Up at Night. Edited by John Brockman. Narrated by Peter Berkrot, Antony Ferguson, Michelle Ford, and Joanna Perrin. Preface. The Edge Question. In 1981, I founded the Reality Club, an attempt to gather together those people exploring the themes of the post-industrial age. In 1997, the Reality Club went online, rebranded as Edge. The ideas presented on Edge are speculative. They represent the frontiers in such areas as evolutionary biology, genetics, computer science, neurophysiology, psychology, cosmology, and physics. Emerging out of these contributions is a new natural philosophy, new ways of understanding physical systems, new ways of thinking that call into question many of our basic assumptions. For each of the anniversary editions of Edge, I and a number of Edge stalwarts, including Stuart Brand, Kevin Kelly, and George Dyson, get together to plan the annual Edge question, usually one that comes to one or another of us or our correspondents in the middle of the night. It's not easy coming up with a question. As the late James Lee Byers, my friend and sometime collaborator, used to say, I can answer the question, but am I bright enough to ask it? We look for questions that inspire unpredictable answers, that provoke people into thinking thoughts they normally might not have. The 2013 Edge Question. What should we be worried about? We worry because we are built to anticipate the future. Nothing can stop us from worrying. But science can teach us how to worry better, and when to stop worrying. The respondents to this year's question were asked to tell us something that, for scientific reasons, worries them, particularly something that doesn't seem to be on the popular radar yet, and why it should be. Or tell us about something they've stopped worrying about, even if others still do, and why it should drop off the radar. The Real Risk Factors for War, by Steven Pinker, Johnstone Family Professor, Department of Psychology, Harvard University. Author, The Better Angels of Our Nature, Why Violence Has Declined. Today, the vast majority of the world's people do not have to worry about dying in war. Since 1945, wars between great powers and developed states have essentially vanished. And since 1991, wars in the rest of the world have become fewer and less deadly. But how long will this trend last? Many people have assured me that it must be a momentary respite, and that a big one is just around the corner. Maybe they're right. The world has plenty of unknown unknowns, and perhaps some unfathomable cataclysm will wallop us out of the blue. But since, by definition, we have no idea what the unknown unknowns are, we can't constructively worry about them. What then about the known unknowns? Are certain risk factors numbering our days of relative peace? In my view, most people are worrying about the wrong ones, or are worrying about them for the wrong reasons. Resource shortages. Will nations go to war over the last dollop of oil, water, or strategic minerals? It's unlikely. First, resource shortages are self-limiting. As a resource becomes scarcer and thus more expensive, technologies for finding and extracting it improve, or substitutes are found. Also, wars are rarely fought over scarce physical resources, unless you subscribe to the unfalsifiable theory that all wars, regardless of stated motives, are really about resources. Vietnam was about tungsten, Iraq was about oil, and so on. Physical resources can be divided or traded, so compromises are always available. Not so for psychological motives such as glory, fear, revenge, or ideology. Climate change. There are many reasons to worry about climate change, but major war is probably not among them. Most studies have failed to find a correlation between environmental degradation and war. Environmental crises can cause local skirmishes, but a major war requires a political decision that a war would be advantageous. The 1930s Dust Bowl did not cause an American Civil War. When we did have a civil war, its causes were very different. Drones. The whole point of drones is to minimize loss of life, compared to indiscriminate forms of destruction such as artillery, aerial bombardment, tank battles, and search-and-destroy missions, which killed orders of magnitude more people than drone attacks in Afghanistan and Pakistan. Cyber warfare. No doubt cyber attacks will continue to be a nuisance, and I'm glad that experts are worrying about them. But the cyber Pearl Harbor that brings civilization to its knees may be as illusory as the Y2K bug apocalypse. Should we really expect that the combined efforts of governments, universities, corporations, and programmer networks will be outsmarted for extended periods by some teenagers in Bulgaria? Or by government-sponsored hackers in technologically backward countries? Could they escape detection indefinitely? And would they provoke retaliation for no strategic purpose? And even if they did muck up the internet for a while, could the damage really compare to being blitzed, firebombed, or nuked? Nuclear inevitability. It's obviously important to worry about nuclear accidents, terrorism, and proliferation because of the magnitude of the devastation nuclear weapons could wreak, regardless of the probabilities. But how high are the probabilities? The 68-year history of non-use of nuclear weapons casts doubt on the common narrative that we are still on the brink of nuclear Armageddon. That narrative requires two extraordinary propositions. One, that leaders are so spectacularly irrational, reckless, and suicidal that they have kept the world in jeopardy of mass annihilation. And two, we have enjoyed a spectacularly improbable run of good luck. Perhaps. But instead of believing in two riveting and unlikely propositions, perhaps we should believe in one boring and likely one. That world leaders, although stupid and short-sighted, are not that stupid and short-sighted, and have taken steps to minimize the chance of nuclear war, which is why nuclear war has not taken place. As for nuclear terrorism, though there was a window of vulnerability for theft of weapons and fissile material after the fall of the Soviet Union, most nuclear security experts believe it has shrunk and will soon be closed. Refer to John Mueller's Atomic Obsession. What the misleading risk factors have in common is that they contain the cognitive triggers of fear, documented by Slovic, Kahneman, and Tversky. They are vivid, novel, undetectable, uncontrollable, catastrophic, and involuntarily imposed on their victims. In my view, there are threats to peace that we should worry about, but the real risk factors, the ones that actually caused catastrophic wars, such as the world wars, wars of religion, and the major civil wars, don't press the buttons of our lurid imaginations. Narcissistic leaders. The ultimate weapon of mass destruction is a state. When a state is taken over by a leader with the classic triad of narcissistic symptoms, grandiosity, need for admiration, and lack of empathy, the result can be imperial adventures with enormous human costs. Groupism. The ideal of human rights, that the ultimate moral good is the flourishing of individual people, while groups are social constructions designed to further that good, is surprisingly recent and unnatural. People, at least in public, are apt to argue that the ultimate moral good is the glory of the group, the tribe, religion, nation, class, or race, and that individuals are expendable like the cells of a body. Perfect justice. Every group has suffered depredations and humiliations in its past. When groupism combines with a thirst for revenge, a group may feel justified in exacting damage on some other group, inflamed by a moralistic certitude that makes compromise tantamount to treason. Utopian ideologies. If you have a religious or political vision of a world that will be infinitely good forever, any amount of violence is justified to bring about that world, and anyone standing in its way is infinitely evil and deserving of unlimited punishment. warfare as a normal or necessary tactic. Clausewitz characterized war as the continuation of policy by other means. Many political and religious ideologies go a step further and consider violent struggle to be the driver of dialectical progress, revolutionary liberation, or the realization of a messianic age. The relative peace we have enjoyed since 1945 is a gift of values and institutions that militate against these risks. Democracy selects for responsible stewards rather than charismatic despots. The ideal of human rights protects people from being treated as cannon fodder, collateral damage, or eggs to be broken for a revolutionary omelet. The maximization of peace and prosperity has been elevated over the rectification of historic injustices or the implementation of utopian fantasies. Conquest is stigmatized as aggression and becomes a taboo rather than a natural aspiration of nations or an everyday instrument of policy. None of these protections is natural or permanent, and the possibility of their collapsing is what makes me worry. Perhaps some charismatic politician is working his way up the Chinese nomenclatura and dreams of overturning the intolerable insult of Taiwan once and for all. Perhaps an aging Putin will seek historical immortality and restore Russian greatness by swallowing a former Soviet republic or two. Perhaps a utopian ideology is fermenting in the mind of a cunning fanatic somewhere who will take over a major country and try to impose it elsewhere. It's natural to worry about physical stuff like weaponry and resources. What we should really worry about is psychological stuff like ideologies and norms. As the UNESCO slogan puts it, since wars begin in the minds of men, it is in the minds of men that the defenses of peace must be constructed. Madness by Werner Vinge, mathematician, computer scientist, Hugo Award-winning novelist, A Fire Upon the Deep, Rainbow's End. There are many things we know to worry about. Some are very likely events, but by themselves not existential threats to civilization. Others could easily destroy civilization and even life on Earth. But the chances of such disasters occurring in the near historical future seem to be vanishingly small. There is a known possibility that stands out for being both likely in the next few decades and capable of destroying our civilization. It's prosaic and banal, something dismissed by many as a danger that the 20th century confronted and definitively rejected. That is war between great nations, especially when fought under a doctrine of mutually assured destruction. MAD. Arguments against the plausibility of mad warfare are especially believable these days. Mad war benefits no one. 20th century USA and USSR, even in the depths of the mad years, were sincerely desperate to avoid tipping over into mad warfare. That sincerity is a big reason why humanity got through the century without general nuclear war. Unfortunately, the 20th century is our only test case, and the mad warfare threat has characteristics that made surviving the 20th century more a matter of luck than wisdom. Mad involves very long timescales and very short ones. At the long end, the threat is driven by social and geopolitical issues in much the same way as with unintended wars of the past. At the other extreme, mad involves complex automation controlling large systems, operating faster than any real-time human response, much less careful judgment. Breakers, vandals, griefers, have more leverage than makers, builders, creators, even though the makers far outnumber the breakers. This is the source of some of our greatest fears about technology, that if weapons of mass destruction are cheap enough, then the relatively small percentage of breakers will be sufficient to destroy civilization. If that possibility is scary, then the mad threat should be terrifying. For with mad planning, it is hundreds of thousands of creative and ingenious people in the most powerful societies, many of the best of the makers, powered by the riches of the planet, who work to create a mutually unsurvivable outcome. In the most extreme case, the resulting weapon systems must function on the shortest of timescales, thus moving the threat into the realm of thermodynamic inevitability. For the time, decades, in which we and our interests are undefendable, and still confined to a volume smaller than the scope of our weapons, the threat of mad warfare will be the winner in rankings of likely destructiveness. There's a lot we can do to mitigate the threat of madness. A resurrection of full-blown mad planning will probably be visible to the general public. We should resist arguments that mad doctrine is a safe strategy with regard to weapons of mass destruction. We should study the dynamics of the beginning of unintended wars of the past, in particular World War I. There are plenty of similarities between our time and the first few years of the last century. We have much optimism, the feeling that our era is different. And what about entangling alliances? Are there small players with the ability to bring heavyweights into the action? How does the possibility of N-way madness affect these risks? With all the things we have to worry about, there is also an overwhelmingly positive counterweight. Billions of good, smart people, and the databases and networks that now empower them. This is an intellectual force that trumps all institutions of the past. Humanity, plus its automation, is quite capable of anticipating and countering myriad possible calamities. If we can avoid blowing ourselves up, we will have time to create things so marvelous that their upside is, worrisomely, beyond imagination.
We Are in Denial About Catastrophic Risks, by Martin Rees, Astronomer Royal, former President, the Royal Society, Emeritus Professor of Cosmology and Astrophysics, University of Cambridge, author, From Here to Infinity, A Vision for the Future of Science. Those of us fortunate enough to live in the developed world fret too much about minor hazards of everyday life, improbable air crashes, carcinogens in food, and so forth. But we are less secure than we think. We should worry far more about scenarios that have thankfully not yet happened, but which, if they occurred, could cause such worldwide devastation that even once would be too often. Much has been written about possible ecological shocks triggered by the collective impact on the biosphere of a growing and more demanding world population, and about the social and political tensions stemming from scarcity of resources or climate change. But even more worrying are the downsides of powerful new technologies, cyber, bio, and nano. We're entering an era where a few individuals could, via error or terror, trigger a societal breakdown with such extreme suddenness that palliative government actions would be overwhelmed. Some would dismiss these concerns as an exaggerated jeremiad. After all, human societies have survived for millennia despite storms, earthquakes, and pestilence. But these human-induced threats are different. They are newly emergent, so we have a limited time base for exposure to them and can't be so sanguine that we would survive them for long, nor about the ability of governments to cope with disaster strikes. And of course, we have zero grounds for confidence that we can survive the worst that even more powerful future technologies could do. The Anthropocene era, when the main global threats come from humans and not from nature, began with the mass deployment of thermonuclear weapons. Throughout the Cold War, there were several occasions when the superpowers could have stumbled toward nuclear Armageddon through muddle or miscalculation. Those who lived anxiously through the Cuban Missile Crisis would have been not merely anxious, but paralytically scared had they realized just how close the world then was to catastrophe. Only later did we learn that President Kennedy assessed the odds of nuclear war, at one stage, as somewhere between 1 out of 3 and even. And only when he was long retired did Robert McNamara state frankly that we came within a hair's breadth of nuclear war without realizing it. It's no credit to us that we escaped. Khrushchev and Kennedy were lucky as well as wise. It is now conventionally asserted that nuclear deterrence worked. In a sense, it did. But that doesn't mean it was a wise policy. If you play Russian roulette with one or two bullets in the barrel, you are more likely to survive than not. But the stakes would need to be astonishingly high, or the value you place on your life inordinately low, for this to seem a wise gamble. But we were dragooned into just such a gamble throughout the Cold War era. It would be interesting to know what level of risk other leaders thought they were exposing us to, and what odds most European citizens would have accepted if they'd been asked to give informed consent. For my part, I would not have chosen to risk a 1 in 3, or even 1 in 6 chance of a disaster that would have killed hundreds of millions and shattered the physical fabric of all our cities, even if the alternative were a certainty of a Soviet invasion of Western Europe. And of course, the devastating consequences of thermonuclear war would have spread far beyond the countries that faced a direct threat. The threat of global annihilation involving tens of thousands of H-bombs is thankfully in abeyance, even though there is now more reason to worry that smaller nuclear arsenals might be used in a regional context, or even by terrorists. But when we recall the geopolitical convulsions of the last century, two world wars, the rise and fall of the Soviet Union, and so forth, we can't rule out, later in the present century, a drastic global realignment leading to a standoff between new superpowers. So a new generation may face its own Cuba, and one that could be handled less well or less luckily than the Cuban Missile Crisis was. We will always have to worry about thermonuclear weapons, but a new trigger for societal breakdown will be the environmental stresses consequent on climate change. Many still hope that our civilization can segue toward a low-carbon future without trauma and disaster. My pessimistic guess, however, is that global annual carbon dioxide emissions won't be turned around in the next 20 years. But by then we'll know, perhaps from advanced computer modeling, but also from how much global temperatures have actually risen by then, whether or not the feedback from water vapor and clouds strongly amplifies the effect of carbon dioxide itself in creating a greenhouse effect. If these feedbacks are indeed important, and the world consequently seems on a rapidly warming trajectory because international efforts to reduce emissions haven't been successful, there may be a pressure for panic measures. These would have to involve a Plan B, being fatalistic about continuing dependence on fossil fuels, but combating its effects by some form of geoengineering. That would be a political nightmare. Not all nations would want to adjust the thermostat the same way, and the science would still not be reliable enough to predict what would actually happen. Even worse, techniques such as injecting dust into the stratosphere, or seeding the oceans, may become cheap enough that plutocratic individuals could finance and implement them. This is a recipe for dangerous and possible runaway unintended consequences, especially if some want a warmer Arctic, whereas others want to avoid further warming of the land at lower latitudes. Nuclear weapons are the worst downside of 20th century science, but there are novel concerns stemming from the effects of fast-developing 21st century technologies. Our interconnected world depends on elaborate networks, electric power grids, air traffic control, international finance, just-in-time delivery, and so forth. Unless these are highly resilient, their manifest benefits could be outweighed by catastrophic, albeit rare, breakdowns cascading through the system. Moreover, a contagion of social and economic breakdown would spread worldwide via computer networks and digital wildfire, literally at the speed of light. The threat is terror as well as error. Concern about cyber attack, by criminals or by hostile nations, is rising sharply. Synthetic biology, likewise, offers huge potential for medicine and agriculture, but it could facilitate bioterror. It is hard to make a clandestine H-bomb, but millions will have the capability and resources to misuse these dual-use technologies. Freeman Dyson looks towards an era when children can design and create new organisms just as routinely as he, when young, played with a chemistry set. Were this to happen, our ecology, and even our species, would surely not survive unscathed for long. And should we worry about another sci-fi scenario? That a network of computers could develop a mind of its own and threaten us all? In a media landscape oversaturated with sensational science stories, end-of-the-world Hollywood productions, and Mayan apocalypse warnings. It may be hard to persuade the wide public that there are indeed things to worry about that could arise as unexpectedly as the 2008 financial crisis and have a far greater impact. I'm worried that by 2050, desperate efforts to minimize or cope with a cluster of risks with low probability but catastrophic consequences may dominate the political agenda.
Living Without the Internet for a Couple of Weeks, by Daniel C. Dennett, philosopher, university professor, co-director, Center for Cognitive Studies, Tufts University, author, Intuition Pumps and Other Tools for Thinking. In the early 1980s, I was worried that the computer revolution was going to reinforce and amplify the divide between the well-to-do Western technocrats and those around the world who couldn't afford computers and similar high-tech gadgetry. I dreaded a particularly malignant sorting of the haves and have-nots, with the rich getting ever richer and the poor being ever more robbed of political and economic power by their lack of access to the new information technology. I started devoting some serious time and effort to raising the alarm about this and trying to think of programs that would forestall or alleviate it. But before I'd managed to make any significant progress, the issue was happily swept out of my hands by the creation of the Internet. I was an ARPANET user, but that didn't help me anticipate what was coming. We've certainly seen a lot of rich technocrats getting richer, but we've also seen the most profoundly democratizing and leveling spread of technology in history. Cell phones and laptops, and now smartphones and tablets, put worldwide connectivity in the hands of billions, adding to the inexpensive transistor radios and television sets that led the way. The planet has become informationally transparent in a way nobody imagined only 40 years ago. This is wonderful, mostly. Religious institutions that could always rely in the past on the relative ignorance of their flock must now revise their proselytizing and indoctrinating policies or risk extinction. Dictators face the dire choice between maximal suppression, turning their nations into prisons, or tolerating an informed and well-connected opposition. Knowledge really is power, as people are coming to realize all over the world. This leveling does give us something new to worry about, however. We have become so dependent on this technology that we have created a shocking new vulnerability. We really don't have to worry much about an impoverished teenager making a nuclear weapon in his slum. It would cost millions of dollars and be hard to do inconspicuously, given the exotic materials required. But such a teenager with a laptop and an internet connection can explore the world's electronic weak spots for hours every day, almost undetectably, at almost no cost and very slight risk of being caught and punished. Yes, the internet is brilliantly designed to be so decentralized and redundant that it's almost invulnerable. But robust as it isn't perfect. Goliath hasn't been knocked out yet, but thousands of Davids are busily learning what they need to know to contrive a trick that will even the playing field with a vengeance. They may not have much money, but we won't have any either if the internet goes down. I think our choice is simple. We can wait for them to annihilate what we have, which is becoming more likely every day, or we can begin thinking about how to share what we have with them. In the meantime, it would be prudent to start brainstorming about how to keep panic at bay if a long-term disruption of large parts of the internet were to occur. Will hospitals and fire stations, and supermarkets and gas stations and pharmacies, keep functioning? And how will people be able to get information they trust? Cruise ships oblige their paying customers to walk through a lifeboat drill the first day at sea. And while it isn't a popular part of the cruise, people are wise to comply. Panic can be contagious, and when that happens, people make crazy and regrettable decisions. As long as we insist on living in the fast lane, we should learn how to get on and off without creating mayhem. Perhaps we should design and institute nationwide lifeboat drills to raise consciousness about what it would be like to have to cope with a long-term internet blackout. When I try to imagine what the major problems would be and how they could be coped with, I find I have scant confidence in my hunches. Are there any experts on this topic? Safe Mode for the Internet by George Dyson, science historian, author, Turing's Cathedral, The Origins of the Digital Universe. Sooner or later, by intent or by accident, we will face a catastrophic breakdown of the Internet. Yet we have no plan B in place to reboot a rudimentary low-bandwidth emergency communication network if the high-bandwidth system we've come to depend on fails. In the event of a major network disruption, most of us will have no idea what to do except to try and check the Internet for advice. As the system begins to recover, the resulting overload may bring that recovery to a halt. The ancestor of the Internet was the store and forward punched paper tape telegraph network. This low-bandwidth, high-latency system was sufficient to convey important messages like "send ammunition" or "arriving New York December 12, much love, stop." We need a low-bandwidth, high-latency store and forward message system that can run in emergency mode on an ad hoc network, assembled from mobile phones and laptop computers, even if the main networks fail. We should keep this system on standby and periodically exercise it, along with a network of volunteers trained in network first aid, the way we train lifeguards and babysitters in CPR. These first responders, like the amateur radio operators who restore communications after natural disasters, would prioritize essential communications, begin the process of recovery, and relay instructions as to what to do next. Most computers, from your car's engine controller to your desktop, can be rebooted into safe mode to get you home. But no safe mode for the Internet? We should be worried about that. The Fragility of Complex Systems by Randolph Ness, professor of psychiatry and psychology, University of Michigan, co-author with George C. Williams, Why We Get Sick. On the morning of August 31st, 1859, the sun ejected a giant burst of charged particles. They hit Earth 18 hours later, creating auroras so bright that at 1 o'clock a.m. birds sang and people thought morning had dawned. Currents induced in telegraph wires prevented transmission, and sparks from the wires set papers aflame. According to data from ice cores, solar ejections this intense occur about every 500 years. A 2008 National Academy of Sciences report concluded that a similar event now would cause extensive social and economic disruptions. Power outages would last for months, and there would be no GPS navigation, cell phone communication, or air travel. Geomagnetic storms sound like a pretty serious threat, but I am far less concerned about them than I am about the effects of many possible events on the complex systems we have become dependent on. Any number of events that once would have been manageable now will have catastrophic effects. Complex systems like the markets, transportation, and the Internet seem stable, but their complexity makes them inherently fragile. Because they are efficient, massive complex systems grow like weeds, displacing slow markets, small farmers, slow communication media, and local information processing systems. When they work, they are wonderful, but when they fail, we will wonder why we did not recognize the dangers of depending on them. It would not take a geomagnetic storm to stop trucks and planes from transporting the goods that make modern life possible. An epidemic or bioterrorist attack would be sufficient. Even a few decades ago, food was produced close to population centers. Now, world distribution networks prevent famine nearly everywhere and make mass starvation more likely if they are disrupted suddenly. Accurate GPS has been available to civilians for less than 20 years. When it fails, commuters will only be inconvenienced, but most air and water transport will stop. The Internet was designed to survive all manner of attacks, but our reckless dependency on it is nonetheless astounding. When it fails, Factories and power stations will shut down. Air and train travel will stop. Hospitals and schools will be paralyzed. And most commerce will cease. What will happen when people cannot buy groceries? Social chaos is a pallid phrase for the likely scenarios. Modern markets exemplify the dangers of relying on complex systems. Economic chaos from the failures of massively leveraged bets is predictable. That governments have been unable to establish controls is astonishing, given that the world economic system came within days of collapse just 5 years ago. Complex trading systems fail for reasons that are hard to grasp, even by investigations after the fact. The flash crash of May 6, 2010, wiped out over $1 trillion of value in minutes, thanks to high-frequency trading algorithms interacting with one another in unpredictable ways. You might think this would have resulted in regulations to prevent any possibility of recurrence, but many flash crashes continue, and the larger system remains vulnerable. These are examples because they have already happened. The larger dangers come from the hidden fragility of complex systems. James Crutchfield, of the Complexity Sciences Center at University of California, Davis, has written clearly about the risks, but as far as I can tell, few are paying attention. We should. Protecting us from catastrophes caused by our dependency on fragile complex systems is something governments can and should do. We need to shift our focus from this or that threat to the vulnerabilities of modern complex systems to any number of threats. Our body politic is like an immune-compromised patient, vulnerable to collapse from numerous agents. Instead of just studying the threats, we need scientists to study the various ways that complex systems fail, how to identify those that make us most vulnerable, and what actions can prevent otherwise inevitable catastrophes.
A Synthetic World by Sirian Sumner, Senior Lecturer, School of Biological Sciences, University of Bristol. Synthetic biology is Legoland for natural scientists. We take nature's building blocks apart and piece them back together again in a way that suits us better. We can combine genetic functions to reprogram new biological pathways with predictable behaviors. We spent the last decade imagining how this will improve society and the environment. We are now realizing these dreams. We can make yogurt that mops up cholera. We can manufacture yeast to power our cars. We can engineer microorganisms to clean up our environment. Soon we'll be using living organisms to mimic electrical engineering solutions. Biocomputers programmed to follow logic gates just as computers do. We will have materials stronger than steel made from animal products. Could this be the end of landfill? There's no doubt that synthetic biology will revolutionize our lives in the 21st century. I worry about where synthetic biology is going next, and specifically what happens when it gets out of the lab into the natural world and the public domain. Biological engineering started outside the lab. We've been modifying plants and animals since the advent of agriculture, about 12,000 years ago, through breeding and artificial selection for domestication. We've ensnared yeast and bacteria to make beer, wine and cheese. We've tamed wolves to be man's best friend. We've cajoled grass into being a high-nutrient source. Synthetic biology is a new packaging that describes how we've got an awful lot better at manipulating natural systems to suit our whims. A plug-and-play approach is being developed, for example, biobricks, to facilitate manipulations at the molecular level. In the future, tried and tested genetic modules may be slotted together by non-experts to create their own bioengineered product. Our children's children could be getting bio-Lego for Christmas to build their own synthetic pets. Synthetic biology has tremendous commercial potential beyond the Lego and is estimated to be worth over $10 billion by 2016. Currently, progress is focused on small things, like individual gene networks or microorganisms. But there is potential too for the larger, more charismatic organisms, specifically the fluffy or endangered ones. These species capture the interests of the public, business and entrepreneurs. This is what I am worried about. We can make a new whole organism from a single stem cell, for example Dolly and Company. We can uncover the genome sequence, complete with epigenetic programming instructions, for practically any extant organism within a few weeks. With this toolkit, we could potentially recreate any living organism on the planet. Animal populations on the brink of extinction could be restocked with better, hardier forms. We are a stone's throw away from recreating extinct organisms. The woolly mammoth genome was sequenced in 2008, and Japanese researchers are reputedly cloning it now, using extant elephant relatives as surrogate mothers. Synthetic biology makes resurrecting extinct animals much more achievable, because any missing genomic information can be replaced with a plug-and-play genetic module. A contained collection of resurrected animals is certainly a wow factor, and it might help uncover their secret lives and explain why they went extinct. But, as Hollywood tells us, even a Jurassic Park cannot be contained for long. There are already attempts to recreate ancient ecosystems through the reintroduction of the descendants of extinct megafauna, for example, Pleistocene Park in Russia, and synthetic woolly mammoths may complete the set. Could synthetic biology be used to resurrect species that fit better or present less of a threat to humans? A friendly mammoth, perhaps. Extinct, extant, friendly or fierce. I worry about the consequences of biosynthetic aliens being introduced into a naive and vulnerable environment, becoming invasive and devastating native ecosystems. I worry that if we can recreate any animal, why should we bother conserving any in the first place? Synthetic biology is currently tightly regulated, along the same lines as genetically modified organisms, GMOs. But when biosynthetic products overflow into the natural world, it will be harder to keep control. Let's look at this from the molecular level, which arguably we have more control over than the organism level or the ecosystem level. We can shuffle genes or whole genomes to create something that nature did not get around to creating. But a biological unit does not exist in isolation. Genes, protein complexes, and cells all function in modules, a composite of units, finely tuned by evolution in a changeable environment to work together. Modules may be swapped around, allowing plasticity in a system, but there are rules to rewiring. Synthetic biology relies on a good understanding of these rules. Do we really understand the molecular rules enough to risk releasing our synthetic creations into natural ecosystems? We barely understand the epigenetic processes that regulate cell differentiation in model organisms in controlled lab conditions. How do we deal with the epigenome in a synthetic genome, especially one destined to exist in an environment very different from its original one 10,000 years ago? Ecology is the Play-Doh of evolution. Ecosystem components get pushed and pulled, changing form, function, and relationships. We might be able to create a bio unit that looks perfect and performs perfectly in the lab, but we cannot control how ecology and evolution might rewire our synthetic unit in an ecosystem, nor can we predict how that synthetic unit might rewire the ecosystem and its inhabitants. Molecular control mechanisms are engineered into the microorganisms we use to clean up toxic spills in the environment, preventing them from evolving and spreading. Can we put a stop-evolving switch into a more complex organism? How do we know that it won't evolve around such a switch? And what happens if, when, such organisms interbreed with native species? What the disruption of the engineered modules or their transfer to other organisms might lead to is unimaginable. To sum up, I worry about the natural world becoming naturally unnatural.
What is Conscious? By Timo Hanne, Managing Director, Digital Science, Former Director, Nature.com, Co-Organizer, Sci-Fu. In an episode of the 1980s British TV series Tales of the Unexpected, an amateur botanist discovers that plants emit agonized screams when pruned, though at frequencies well beyond human hearing. So overcome is he with sympathy for this suffering vegetation, and so apparently bizarre his demands that a local doctor give medical attention to his trees, that he is quickly packed off to an asylum. A preposterous flight of fancy from Roald Dahl's ever-fertile imagination, no doubt. But this conceit also raises a profoundly serious point. We have next to no idea which things in the world around us are conscious and which are not. This might seem like an abstract philosophical issue, but on the contrary, consciousness is the substrate of all suffering and pleasure, and thus the mediator of everything truly important to us. If there were no subjective experience, there would be no such things as kindness, love, or joy. However sublime our universe, it would be inconsequential without a consciousness to perceive it. True, in a world with no subjective experience, there would also be no cruelty, pain, or worrying, including that of the kind I am doing now. But this is precisely the point. How are we to maximize happiness and minimize suffering if we do not reliably know where and when they can exist? Our usual rule of thumb for the presence of consciousness is to assess, based on superficial cues, how similar to ourselves something appears to be. Thus, a dog is more conscious than a duck, which in turn is more conscious than a daffodil. But our intuitions about so many things, from the motions of celestial objects to the likelihood of winning the lottery, are so often wrong that we are foolish to rely on them for something as important as the ultimate source of all joy and strife. Famously, and ironically, the only thing of which we can be truly certain is the existence of our own subjective experience, and we see the physical world only through this dark glass. Yet the scientific method has proved a remarkable tool for clarifying our view and enabling us to develop an elaborate, apparently objective consensus about how the world works. Unfortunately, having provided us with an escape route from our own subjectivity, science leaves us almost completely impotent to probe the nature and origins of subjective experience itself. The truth is that we have no idea what things have consciousness, where it comes from, or even what it is. All we really know is how it feels. That may sound like an odd statement to come from a former neuroscientist. Certainly, we understand an impressive amount about how the brain functions as a physical system, and also about the ways in which different brain states correspond to various reported subjective experiences. But this is a long way from understanding consciousness well enough to be able to do what really matters. Determine with reasonable certainty what does and does not possess it, and to what degree. This is a fabulously hard task. Daniel Dennett's outstanding book, Consciousness Explained, for all its considerable eloquence and erudition, falls well short of the claim of its title. Indeed, we have tied ourselves in such intellectual knots over consciousness that it is hard to discern more than incremental progress since Descartes. For an example of the difficulties involved, consider John Searle's celebrated Chinese Room thought experiment, which purports to show, contrary to Alan Turing's claims, that input-output characteristics alone are insufficient to determine the existence of a conscious mind. Intuitively, this conclusion seems right. A sleeping person, immobile and inattentive, might nevertheless be experiencing vivid dreams. Conversely, I can drive a familiar route without forming any conscious record of the journey that took me to my destination. But the Chinese Room does nothing to prove this thesis, for it is a thought experiment. And the trouble with thought experiments is that the researcher chooses not only the experimental conditions, but also the results. This makes them useful for testing the internal consistency of ideas, but almost useless for probing mysterious, apparently emergent phenomena like consciousness. To see this, carry out the same thought experiment on the 1.4-kilogram lump of electrophysiological goo called the human brain, and if you're being consistent, you'll get the same result. There appears to be no conscious understanding anywhere in sight. Over the last decade or two, neuroscientists have at last shed their qualms about investigating the mysterious and transcendent phenomenon of consciousness, with some interesting results. Our best guess these days is that consciousness arises when certain types and quantities of information are integrated in the brain in certain ways. But this is still very hand-wavy, not only because the parameters are so ill-defined, but also because we don't even know exactly what we mean by information. After all, every physical system contains information of one sort or another, and computes its own behavior. So the brain is far from unique in this respect. What's more, even if we understood exactly what kind of information has to be brought together in precisely what combinations and quantities to ignite a spark of consciousness, we'd still be in the dark as to whether this is an emergent or fundamental phenomenon, and why this physical universe even allows subjective experience to exist at all. Those mysteries remain as dark to us as the nature of existence itself. Toward the end of 2012, doctors picked up the first message, via a brain scan, from a patient in a persistent vegetative state. But if input-output characteristics can't be trusted, and they probably can't, then we really have no way of confirming whether this represented a conscious act or an insensible physical response. Similarly, what of patients under anesthetic? For all we know, they may be in agony during their operations, even if they have no memory of it afterward. And so on and on, from human embryos to birds, insects, and yes, even plants. Not to mention all those computers we're bringing into existence. Might they have an inner life too? It is possible that we are rare, fleeting specks of awareness in an unfeeling cosmic desert, the only witnesses to its wonder. It is also possible that we are living in a universal sea of sentience, surrounded by ecstasy and strife that is open to our influence. Sensible beings that we are, both possibilities should worry us. Will there be a singularity within our lifetime? By Max Tegmark, physicist, MIT. Researcher, Precision Cosmology. Scientific Director, FQXI. Foundational Questions Institute. Although life as we know it gets a lot of flack, I worry that we don't appreciate it enough and are too complacent about losing it. As our spaceship Earth blazes through cold and barren space, it both sustains and protects us. It's stocked with major but limited supplies of water, food, and fuel. Its atmosphere keeps us warm and shielded from the sun's harmful ultraviolet rays. Its magnetic field shelters us from lethal cosmic rays. Surely any responsible spaceship captain would make it a top priority to safeguard his craft's future existence by avoiding asteroid collisions, onboard explosions, overheating, ultraviolet shield destruction, and premature depletion of ship supplies. Yet our spaceship crew hasn't made any of these issues a top priority, devoting, by my estimate, less than a millionth of its resources to them. In fact, our spaceship doesn't even have a captain. Many have blamed this dismal performance on life as we know it, arguing that since our environment is changing, we humans need to change with it. We need to be technologically enhanced, perhaps with smartphones, smart glasses, brain implants, and ultimately by merging with superintelligent computers. Does the idea of life as we know it getting replaced by more advanced life sound appealing or appalling to you? That probably depends on the circumstances, and in particular on whether you view the future beings as our descendants or our conquerors. If parents have a child who's smarter than they are, who learns from them and then goes out and accomplishes what they could only dream of, they'll probably feel happy and proud, even if they know they can't live to see it all. Parents of a highly intelligent mass murderer feel differently. We might feel that we have a similar parent-child relationship with future AIs, regarding them as the heirs of our values. It will therefore make a huge difference whether or not future advanced life retains our most cherished goals. Another key factor is whether the transition is gradual or abrupt. I suspect that few are disturbed by the prospects of humankind gradually evolving, over thousands of years, to become more intelligent and better adapted to our changing environment, perhaps also modifying its physical appearance in the process. On the other hand, many parents would feel ambivalent about having their dream child if they knew it would cost them their lives. If advanced future technology doesn't replace us abruptly, but rather upgrades and enhances us gradually, eventually merging with us, then this might provide both the goal retention and the gradualism required for us to view future technological life forms as our descendants. So what will actually happen? This is something we should be really worried about. The Industrial Revolution has brought us machines that are stronger than we are. The Information Revolution has brought us machines that are smarter than we are in certain limited ways, beating us in chess in 2006, on the quiz show Jeopardy in 2011, and at driving in 2012, when a computer was licensed to drive cars in Nevada after being judged safer than a human. Will computers eventually beat us at all tasks, developing superhuman intelligence? I have little doubt that this can happen. Our brains are a bunch of particles obeying the laws of physics, and there's no physical law precluding particles from being arranged in ways that can perform even more advanced computations. But will it happen anytime soon? Many experts are skeptical, while others, such as Ray Kurzweil, predict it will happen by 2030. What I think is quite clear, however, is that if it happens, the effects will be explosive. As the late Oxford mathematician Irving J. Goode realized in 1965, speculations concerning the first ultra-intelligent machine. Machines with superhuman intelligence could rapidly design even better machines. In 1993, mathematician and science fiction author Werner Vinge called the resulting intelligence explosion the Singularity, arguing that it was a point beyond which it was impossible for us to make reliable predictions. After this, life on Earth would never be the same, either objectively or subjectively. Objectively, whoever or whatever controls this technology would rapidly become the world's wealthiest and most powerful entity, outsmarting all financial markets, out-inventing and out-patenting all human researchers, and out-manipulating all human leaders. Even if we humans nominally merge with such machines, we might have no guarantees about the ultimate outcome, making it feel less like a merger and more like a hostile corporate takeover. Subjectively, these machines wouldn't feel as we do. Would they feel anything at all? I believe that consciousness is the way information feels when being processed. I therefore think it's likely that they, too, would feel self-aware and should be viewed not as mere lifeless machines, but as conscious beings like us, but with a consciousness that subjectively feels quite different from ours. For example, they would probably lack our human fear of death. As long as they've backed themselves up, all they stand to lose are the memories they've accumulated since their latest backup. The ability to readily copy information and software between AIs would probably reduce the strong sense of individuality so characteristic of human consciousness. There would be less of a distinction between you and me if we could trivially share and copy all our memories and abilities. So a group of nearby AIs may feel more like a single organism with a hive mind. In summary, will there be a singularity within our lifetime? And is this something we should work for or against? On the one hand, it might solve most of our problems, even mortality. It could also open up space, the final frontier. Unshackled by the limitations of our human bodies, such advanced life could rise up and eventually make much of our observable universe come alive. On the other hand, it could destroy life as we know it and everything we care about. We are nowhere near consensus on either of these two questions, but that doesn't mean it's rational for us to do nothing about the issue. It could be the best or worst thing ever to happen to life as we know it. So if there's even a 1% chance that there will be a singularity in our lifetime, a reasonable precaution would be to spend at least 1% of our GDP studying the issue and deciding what to do about it. Yet we largely ignore it and are curiously complacent about life as we know it getting transformed. What we should be worried about is that we're not worried.
The Singularity. There's no there, there. By Bruce Sterling. futurist, science fiction author, journalist, critic, author, Love is Strange, a paranormal romance. 20 years have passed since Werner Vinge wrote his remarkably interesting essay about the singularity. This aging sci-fi notion has lost its conceptual teeth. Plus, its chief evangelist, visionary Ray Kurzweil, recently got a straight engineering job with Google. Despite its weird fondness for AR goggles and self-driving cars, Google is not going to finance any eschatological cataclysm in which superhuman intelligence abruptly ends the human era. Google is a firmly commercial enterprise. It's just not happening. All the symptoms are absent. Computer hardware is not accelerating on any exponential runway beyond all hope of control. We're no closer to self-aware machines than we were in the remote 1960s. Modern wireless devices in a modern cloud are an entirely different cyber paradigm than imaginary 1990s minds on non-biological substrates that might allegedly have the computational power of a human brain. A singularity has no business model. No major power group in our society is interested in provoking one. Nobody who matters sees any reason to create one. There's no there there. So, as a pope once remarked, be not afraid. We're getting what Vinge predicted would happen without a singularity, which is a glut of technical riches never properly absorbed. There's all kinds of mayhem in that junkyard, but the AI rapture isn't lurking in there. It's no more to be fretted about than a landing of Martian tripods. Capture by Charles Seif, professor of journalism, NYU, former staff writer, science, author, proofiness, the dark arts of mathematical deception. On April 5th, 2010, deep in the upper Big Branch mine in West Virginia, a spark ignited a huge explosion that rumbled through the tunnels and killed 29 miners, the worst mining disaster in the United States in 40 years. 2 weeks later, the Deepwater Horizon, a drilling rig in the Gulf of Mexico, went up in flames, killing 11 workers and creating the biggest oil spill in history. Though these two disasters seem completely unrelated, they had the same underlying cause. Capture. Federal agencies that regulate industry are supposed to prevent such disasters. Agencies like the Mine Safety and Health Administration, which sets the rules for mines, and the Minerals Management Service, which set the rules for offshore drilling, are supposed to constrain businesses and to act as watchdogs to force everyone to play by the rules. That's the ideal, anyhow. The reality is a bit messier. More often than not, the agencies are reluctant to enforce the regulations they create. When a business gets caught breaking the rules, the regulatory agencies tend to impose penalties amounting to no more than a slap on the wrist. Companies like Massey Energy, which ran Upper Big Branch, and BP, which ran the Deepwater Horizon, flout the rules. And when disaster strikes, everybody wonders why regulators fail to take action, despite numerous warning signs and repeated violations of regulations. In the 1970s, economists, led by future Nobel laureate George Stigler, began to realize that this was the rule, not the exception. Over time, regulatory agencies are systematically drained of their ability to check the power of industry. Even more striking, they're gradually drawn into the orbit of the businesses they're charged with regulating. Instead of acting in the public interest, the regulators wind up as tools of the industry they're supposed to keep watch over. This process, known as regulatory capture, turns regulators from watchdogs into lapdogs. You don't have to look far to see regulatory capture in action. Securities and Exchange Commission officials are often accused of ignoring warnings about fraud, stifling investigations, even helping miscreants avoid paying big fines or going to jail. Look at the Nuclear Regulatory Commission's enforcement reports to see how capable it is of preventing energy companies from violating nuclear power plant safety rules again and again. Regulatory capture isn't limited to the U.S. what caused the Fukushima disaster? Ultimately, it was a breakdown of the regulatory system, caused by reversal of the positions between the regulator and the regulated, at least according to a report prepared by the Japanese Parliament. The regulator had become the regulated. Regulatory capture is just a small part of the story. In my own profession, journalism, we like to think of ourselves as watchdogs, fierce defenders of the public good. But we too are being captured by the industries we're supposed to keep watch on. There's journalistic capture just as there's regulatory capture. It's most marked in fields such as tech reporting, business reporting, White House reporting, fields where you're afraid of losing access to your subjects, where you depend on the industry to feed you stories, where your advertising revenue comes from the very people you're supposed to critique. In all of these fields, you can find numerous reporters who are functionally controlled by the people they're supposed to keep watch over. Even on my own beat, especially on my own beat, science reporting, we're captured. The elaborate system of embargoes and privileged press releases set up by scientific journals and scientific agencies ensures that we report not just what they want, but how and when they want it. We've unwittingly shifted our allegiance from the public we're supposed to serve to the people we're supposed to investigate. Capture is a bigger threat than even Stigler first realized. Any profession that depends to some degree on objectivity and whose work affects the fortunes of a group of people with power and money is subject to capture. Science, a field in which objectivity is paramount, is far from immune. There's evidence that medical researchers who take money from industry tend to see the natural world in a more positive light. In their experiments, drugs seem to work better, patients seem to survive longer, and side effects seem less dangerous. Yet few scientists, even those taking tens or hundreds of thousands of dollars from drug companies or medical device manufacturers, think they serve any master but truth with a capital T. That's what worries me the most about capture. You never know when you're a captive.
The Triumph of the Virtual by Mihai Csikszentmihalyi, Distinguished Professor of Psychology and Management, Founder and Co-Director, Quality of Life Research Center, Claremont Graduate University, Author, A Life Worth Living, Contributions to Positive Psychology. I tried to rank my fears in order of their severity, but soon I realized I would not complete this initial task before the submission deadline, so I decided to use a random number generator to choose among the fears. It turned out not to be a bad choice. Basically, the fear that in one or two generations children will grow up to be adults unable to tell reality from imagination. Of course, humanity has always had a precarious hold on reality, but it looks like we're headed for a quantum leap into an abyss of insubstantiality. I don't know if you have been following the launch of the new 3D version of one of the major multiplayer video games, replete with monsters, orcs, slavering beasts, and all sorts of unsavory characters brandishing lethal weapons. To survive in this milieu, the player needs fast responses and a quick trigger finger. And now let's reflect on the results of what happens when children start playing such games before entering school, and continue to do so into their teens. A child learns about reality through experiences first, not through lectures and books. The incessant warfare he takes part in is not virtual to the child. It is his reality. The events on the screen are more real than the War of Independence or World War II. At a superficial cognitive level, they're aware the game is only a virtual reality, but at a deeper, emotional level, they know it is not. After all, it is happening to them. It's true that some of the oldest and most popular games are based on forms of mayhem. Chess, for instance, consists in eliminating and immobilizing the enemy forces. Infantry, cavalry, messengers, troops mounted on elephants, and the redoubtable queen. The last was actually a misunderstanding. The Persian inventors of the game gave the most important warrior the title of vizier, after the designation for the commanders of the Persian army. The French crusaders, who learned the game as they wandered through the Near East, thought the piece was called Vierge, after the Virgin Mary. Upon their return to Europe, the Virgin became the Queen. But chess, although it can be an obsession, can never be confused with the rest of reality by a sane person. The problem with the new gaming technology is that it has become so realistic that with enough time and with little competition from the child's environment, which tends to be safe, boring, and predictable, it can erase the distinction between virtual and real. It is then a short step for a young man on the brink of sanity to get a hold of one of the various attack weapons so conveniently available, and go on a shooting spree that is a mere continuation of what he has been doing virtually for years. A few decades ago, I started doing research and writing about the impact of indiscriminate television watching, especially on children. Then, as the interactive video games began to appear on the market, it seemed that finally the electronic technology was becoming more child-friendly. Instead of watching passively inane content, children would now have a chance to become engaged in stimulating activities. What I did not have the sense to imagine was that the engagement offered by the new technology would become a Pandora's box containing bait for the reptilian brain to feast on. What scares me now is that children experiencing such reality are going to create a really real world like the one Hieronymus Bosch envisioned, full of spidery creatures, melting objects, and bestial humans.
The Patience Deficit by Nicholas G. Carr, author, The Shallows, What the Internet is Doing to Our Brains. I'm concerned about time, the way we're warping it, and it's warping us. Human beings, like other animals, seem to have remarkably accurate internal clocks. Take away our wristwatches and our cell phones, and we can still make pretty good estimates about time intervals. But that faculty can also be easily distorted. Our perception of time is subjective. It changes with our circumstances and our experiences. When things are happening quickly all around us, delays that would otherwise seem brief begin to seem interminable. Seconds stretch out. Minutes go on forever. Our sense of time, observed William James in his 1890 masterwork, The Principles of Psychology, seems subject to the law of contrast. In a 2009 article in the Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society, the French psychologists Sylvie Droit-Vollet and Sandrine Gill described what they call the paradox of time. Although humans are able to accurately estimate time as if they possess a specific mechanism that allows them to measure time, they wrote, their representations of time are easily distorted by the context. They describe how our sense of time changes with our emotional state. When we're agitated or anxious, for example, time seems to crawl. We lose patience. Our social milieu, too, influences the way we experience time. Studies suggest, write Droit-Vollet and Gill, that individuals match their time with that of others. The activity rhythm of those around us alters our own perception of the passing of time. Given what we know about the variability of our time sense, it seems clear that information and communication technologies would have a particularly strong effect on personal time perception. After all, they often determine the pace of the events we experience, the speed with which we're presented with new information and stimuli, and even the rhythms of our social interactions. That's long been true, but the influence must be particularly strong now that we carry powerful and extraordinarily fast computers around with us. Our gadgets train us to expect near-instantaneous responses to our actions, and we quickly get frustrated and annoyed at even brief delays. I know that my own perception of time has been changed by technology. If I go from using a fast computer or Web Connect Ion to using even a slightly slower one, processes that take just a second or two longer, waking the machine from sleep, launching an application, opening a web page, seem almost intolerably slow. Never before have I been so aware of and annoyed by the passage of mere seconds. Research on web users shows that this is a general phenomenon. Back in 2006, a famous study of online retailing found that a large percentage of online shoppers would abandon a retailing site if its pages took 4 seconds or longer to load. In the years since then, the so-called 4-second rule has been repealed and replaced by the quarter-of-a-second rule. Studies by companies like Google and Microsoft now find it takes a delay of just 250 milliseconds in a page loading for people to start abandoning a site. 250 milliseconds, either slower or faster, is close to the magic number now for competitive advantage on the web, a top Microsoft engineer said in 2012. To put that into perspective, it takes about the same amount of time for you to blink an eye. A recent study of online video viewing provides more evidence of how advances in media and networking technology reduce our patience. Shunmuga Krishnan and Ramesh Sitaraman studied a huge database that documented 23 million video views by nearly 7 million people. They found that people start abandoning a video in droves after a 2-second delay. That won't surprise anyone who has had to wait for a video to begin after clicking the start button. More interesting is the study's finding of a causal link between higher connection speeds and higher abandonment rates. Every time a network gets quicker, we become antsier. As we experience faster flows of information online, we become, in other words, less patient people. But it's not just a network effect. The phenomenon is amplified by the constant buzz of Facebook, Twitter, texting, and social networking in general. Society's activity rhythm has never been so harried. Impatience is a contagion spread from gadget to gadget. All of this has obvious importance to anyone involved in online media or in running data centers. But it also has implications for how all of us think, socialize, and in general, live. If we assume that networks will continue to get faster, a pretty safe bet, then we can also conclude that we'll become more and more impatient, more and more intolerant of even microseconds of delay between action and response. As a result, we'll be less likely to experience anything that requires us to wait, that doesn't provide us with instant gratification. That has cultural as well as personal consequences. The greatest of human works, in art, science, politics, tend to take time and patience both to create and to appreciate. The deepest experiences can't be measured in fractions of seconds. It's not clear whether a technology-induced loss of patience persists even when we're not using the technology. But I would hypothesize, based on what I see in myself and others, that our sense of time is indeed changing in a lasting way. Digital technologies are training us to be more conscious of and more antagonistic toward delays of all sorts, and perhaps more intolerant of moments of time that pass without the arrival of new stimuli. Because our experience of time is so important to our experience of life, it strikes me that these kinds of technology-induced changes in our perceptions can have broad consequences. In any event, it seems like something worth worrying about, if you can spare the time.
The Teenage Brain by Sarah Jane Blakemore, Royal Society University Research Fellow and Professor of Cognitive Neuroscience, University College London, co-author with Jutta Frith, The Learning Brain, Lessons for Education. Until about 15 years ago, it was widely assumed that the majority of brain development occurs in the first few years of life. But recent research on the human brain has demonstrated that many brain regions undergo protracted development throughout adolescence and beyond. This advance in knowledge has intensified old worries and given rise to new ones. It is hugely worrying that so many teenagers around the world don't have access to education while their brains are still developing and being shaped by the environment. We should also worry about our lack of understanding of how our rapidly changing world is shaping the developing teenage brain. Decades of research on early neurodevelopment demonstrated that the environment influences brain development. During the first few months or years of life, an animal must be exposed to particular visual or auditory stimuli for the associated brain cells and connections to develop. In this way, neuronal circuitry is sculpted. This research has focused mostly on early development of sensory brain regions. What about later development of higher-level brain regions, such as prefrontal cortex and parietal cortex, which are involved in decision-making, inhibitory control and planning, as well as social understanding and self-awareness? We know that these brain regions continue to develop throughout adolescence. However, we have very little knowledge about how environmental factors influence the developing teenage brain. This is something that should concern us. There is some recent evidence from the Dunedin Longitudinal Study that adolescence represents a period of brain development particularly sensitive to environmental input. This study reported that persistent cannabis use in adolescence had long-lasting negative consequences on a broad spectrum of cognitive abilities in adulthood. This was not the case if cannabis use started after the age of 18. Could the same be true for other environmental factors? Alcohol, tobacco, drug use, diet, medication, internet usage, gaming. These are all likely to affect the developing brain. The question is how, and we simply don't know the answer. There's a lot of concern about the hours some teenagers spend online and playing video games. But maybe all this worry is misplaced. After all, throughout history, humans have worried about the effects of new technologies on the minds of the next generation. When the printing press was invented, there was anxiety that reading might corrupt young minds, and the same worries were repeated for the invention of radio and television. Maybe we shouldn't be worried at all. It's possible that the developing brains of today's teenagers will be the most adaptable, creative, multitasking brains that have ever existed. There is evidence, from adults, that playing video games improves a range of cognitive functions, such as divided attention and working memory, as well as visual acuity. Much less is known about how gaming, social networking and so on influence the developing adolescent brain. We don't know whether the effects of new technologies on the developing brain are positive, negative or neutral. We need to find out. Adolescence is a period of life when the brain is malleable, and it represents a good opportunity for learning and social development. However, according to UNICEF, 40% of the world's teenagers have no access to secondary school education. The percentage of teenage girls who lack this access is much higher, yet there is strong evidence that the education of girls in developing countries has many significant benefits for family health, population growth rates, child mortality rates, and HIV rates, as well as for women's self-esteem and quality of life. Adolescence represents a time of brain development when teaching and training should be particularly beneficial. I worry about the lost opportunity of denying the world's teenagers access to education.
Who's Afraid of the Big Bad Words? By Benjamin Bergen, Associate Professor, Department of Cognitive Science, University of California, San Diego. Author, Louder Than Words, The New Science of How the Mind Makes Meaning. At around 2 o'clock p.m. on Tuesday, October 30th, 1973, a New York radio station played...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.